بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وسيق الذين اتقوا ربهم إلى الجنة زمرا حتى إذا جاءوها وفتحت أبوابها وقال لهم خزنتها سلام عليكم طبتم فادخلوها خالدين. وقالوا الحمد لله الذي صدقنا وعده وأورثنا الأرض نتبوأ من الجنة حيث نشاء فنعم أجر العاملين. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector, and curer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. MashaAllah and Alhamdulillah, we are indeed in a blessed month, the month of Ramadan, a month in which the gates of Jannah are wide open, Allahu Akbar, and the doors of Jahannam, the gates of Jahannam are slammed shut, and shayateen, the devils, are locked up and put into shackles. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to make the best out of this month of Ramadan. So I thought it all the more appropriate to touch on the description of Jannah, this short talk that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with. And we will be taking a glimpse into Jannah, into paradise. Because after all, the description, when we talk about the description of Jannah, it is not something that we can concoct and come up, fabricate. No. We have to refer back to the Quran or the authentic ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If the Quran or the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described Jannah, then we stick to that description and we don't go further. And if nothing has been mentioned in regard to a particular aspect, then we keep quiet about it and then we don't ask about it, because all of these things are from the ghaybiyat. All of these things are from the unseen world, from the ilmul ghayb, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well aware of. So like I said, the knowledge of the unseen has to be based on either one of the two sources, that is the Quran or the authentic hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at this beautiful hadith Qudsi, which is recorded in Bukhari and Muslim. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, I think most of you all are aware what a hadith Qudsi is. A hadith Qudsi is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is not considered Quran, but rather it is from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah the Almighty states, أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states that I have prepared for my righteous slaves that which no eye has seen. مَلَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ, that which no eye has seen, nor any ear has heard about, nor has it crossed the mind of any human being. You can think of any levels of pleasure, any beautiful architecture, but trust me, the description of Jannah or the reality of Jannah has never ever crossed the mind of any human being for that matter, according to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, فَقْرَأُوا إِن شِئْتُمْ فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, recite if you wish, no person, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ, no person knows what is kept hidden for them of pleasures and reward and joy for what they used to do, for the righteous deeds that they used to do. Allahu Akbar. Something that we need to understand, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the life of this dunya is very, very short. It is temporary, it is short, it is a transitory stage that we are crossing. It is not an abode or a place that we need to latch ourselves onto, because inevitably we are going to leave this station and move on to our perpetual and eternal residence, which is Akhirah, which is Jannah. So the life of this dunya is short, the joys, the pleasures of this dunya are short, in comparison to the pleasures and the joys of Jannah, which are permanent and eternal. Likewise, the hardships of this dunya are also short. So nothing is permanent, everything is temporary. So let us prepare for Akhirah, let us prepare for Jannah. Hadith is again in Bukhari. Sahal ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi radiallahu anhu states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that a space the size of a whip, of a whip that you use to whip the animals, a space the size of a whip in paradise, in Jannah, is better than the whole world and all it contains. It's better than the whole world and all it contains. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states in the Noble Quran, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ومساكن طيبة في جنات عدن ورضوان من الله أكبر ذلك هو الفوز العظيم. Allah the Almighty has promised the believers, men and women, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised the believing men and women gardens. Allahu Akbar. Jannat. Allah has promised gardens under which rivers flow. جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Gardens under which rivers flow, to dwell therein, to live therein forever and ever. And beautiful mansions, Allahu Akbar, beautiful mansions, وَمَسَاكِنَ طَيِّبًا, and beautiful mansions in gardens of perpetual, of eternal bliss. وَرِضْوَانٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرٌ. But the greatest bliss of all is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For that is the supreme pinnacle of pleasure. That is the supreme felicity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all His pleasure. Ameen. Now let us move on. Think of me as a tour guide. Think of me as a tour guide. And I'm going to give you all a tour of Jannah, a glimpse of Jannah, because that is all that we have got. Let's just imagine that the questioning is over. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our questioning easy and make the reckoning easy upon us. Let's imagine that the questioning is over. The questioning is over. The kuffar have been sentenced to Jahannam, and then the munafiqun and the believing men and women were remaining, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sentenced the munafiqun also to Jahannam, and now all that remains are the believers, men and women. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the believing men and women. Now we are waiting to witness the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are waiting to witness Jannah. So now let us talk about the admittance of Jannah. The ayah I recited in the beginning, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا. But those who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who adopted taqwa, they will be driven to paradise. Allahu Akbar. وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا. They will be driven to paradise in throngs and groups. The malaika, The malaika will gather the people and start driving them or moving them towards paradise. Allahu Akbar. Just imagine the bliss, the happiness the people would feel at that time. May Allah the Almighty make us from that group that is being driven towards Jannah. They will be driven until they reach the gates of Jannah. The gates of Jannah will be wide open. And the keepers of Jannah will say, وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ طِبْتُمْ فَادْخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ. The keepers of Jannah will say, peace be unto you, peace be upon you. You have become pure. You all are all pure. So enter into Jannah and abide therein eternally and forever. Allahu Akbar. The gates of Jannah, they will be 8 in number. The gates of Jannah will be 8 in number, unlike the gates of Jahannam, which are 7 in number. The gates of Jannah will be 8 in number. And as we know, there is a special gate, especially for the ones who fast the month of Ramadan. And I think most of you all are aware of that gate. That gate is known as Ar-Rayyan. Allahu Akbar. May Allah the Almighty grant us all the opportunity to enter through that gate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our fasting. The one who fasts for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only those people, those individuals who sincerely fast for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be granted entry into Jannah through that special gate, which is known as Ar-Rayyan. Then we have other gates for the sabirun, for the people who are patient, for the people who established their salah on time, for the people who adopted taqwa, for the people who gave out zakah, for the people who went out in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who fought in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who used to strive in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For each special amal, there is a special gate. Allahu Akbar. And some individuals, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, some of them, two gates of Jannah will be calling them because of their virtue and because of their a'mal. Some of them, three gates of Jannah will be calling out to them. Ya Abdullah, Ya Khalid, come, come, three gates of Jannah, four gates of Jannah, five. And there are even some individuals where all eight gates of Jannah, like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, for example, all eight gates of Jannah will call them, come, come, enter through me. Allahu Akbar. And at that time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the believers will say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the group who will say that. وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي صَدَقَنَا وَعْدًا صَدَقَنَا وَعْدَهُ وَأَوْرَثَنَا الْأَرْضَ نَتَبَوَّأُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ حَيْثُ نَشَاءُ فَنِعْمَ أَجْرُ الْعَامِلِينَ. And they will say, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has fulfilled for us His promise and made us inherit this dunya so that we may settle in paradise wherever we will. And excellent is the reward for the righteous workers, or for the righteous ones who do righteous deeds for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from these groups, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the first group to enter paradise, the first group of people to enter paradise, or let me touch on the first of mankind, the first of mankind to enter paradise will be our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first of mankind, from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam until the last man to ever be born on this earth, the first person to enter Jannah will be our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the first nation to enter Jannah will be the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is us. Allahu Akbar. Look at the privilege of this Ummah. Look at the privilege of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just imagine how much shukr we need to make to be from the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the first member of this Ummah to enter Jannah, the first member of this Ummah to enter Jannah after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. Allahu Akbar. What a great status. What a great honor. Allahu Akbar. How we should envy that status and that honor. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the first group that enters Jannah. Hadith is in Muslim. Anas radiyallahu anhu states, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, that now, just imagine, all of us are gathered in front of the gates of Jannah. Before we enter the hadith, these are my words. Just imagine that all of us are in front of the gates of Jannah, all of the nations. But we know deep within that our nation, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are going to enter Jannah first. And at that moment, now coming to the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that I will come to the gates of Jannah and I will ask for it to be opened. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, scholars explain that he will knock on the gates of Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will knock on the gates of Jannah, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will ask for the gates of Jannah to be opened. The gatekeeper of Jannah will ask, who are you? Because the person, the gatekeeper, will be behind the gate. He will not be able to see who is knocking the gate, the gate of Jannah. He'll ask, who is it knocking the gate? To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will reply, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will not say, I am the prophet of Allah, or I am the messenger of Allah. Nay, out of so much of humbleness and so much of simplicity, being the first person to enter Jannah, look at the privilege, look at the status, look at the honor. But then he will say, it is I, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The gatekeeper will then say, indeed, I was ordered not to open the gate for anyone other than you, Ya Rasulullah. Allahu Akbar. I was ordered not to open the gate for anyone other than you. And then the gates will be flung wide open for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, in regard to the gates of Jannah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, and the hadith is in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, that the distance between the two panels of one gate, you take one gate, between the two panels of one gate, the distance, look at the size of these gates, the distance between the two panels of one gate of Jannah will be the distance of 40 years travel. And some scholars mention that we don't know whether it is traveling by walking, or whether it is a human being's travel, or the distance a horse can travel, or perhaps the distance an angel can travel. Wallahu alam. But in this narration it is mentioned 40 years distance of walking. Allahu Akbar. 40 years. Look at how great and how big one gate of Jannah is. Allahu Akbar. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, but there will come a time when even such a big gate will be crowded and people will throng, and it will be like a bottleneck at the gate. Allahu Akbar. It will be, in another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quotes an example, it will be like a drinking trough, where a drinking tub where the camels gather to drink water. Just as how the camels fight to drink water, the crowds of people will be all thronging together to enter Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all entry into Jannah. Now, the first group to enter paradise, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the first group to enter paradise. Just take this example. You are in the airport. You are in the airport, and sometimes, you know, in the Sri Lankan airport, at times you can walk right into the flight. But at times, you need to wait for the bus to come and take you to go to the plane. So normally what they do is they call out seat numbers. And generally business class, first class is called first. You have to wait. Everybody throngs at the gate at times. They don't listen to the announcement. They throng at the gate, but they don't give them entry. Why? First class and business class is given entry first. They get to waltz into the bus comfortably, and at times seats are kept for them. They sit and they're taken to the plane comfortably. A separate entrance into the plane where there is no crowding, nothing. As they enter, they're given all kind, a newspaper perhaps, things to eat, and etc. But then people who are in the economy class and at times at the very back, they have to enter the last. And at times you are agitated even in the airport. It's just a matter of boarding a plane. But then what about Jannah? Jannah that we have been hearing throughout our lives. That Jannah that we are so excited to witness. If we are put back on that day, on the day when people will be thronging to enter Jannah, and when we see this first group, look at the description, hadith is in Bukhari, when that first group is entering, we will envy that group. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from that group, and let us work towards becoming from that group. Ameen. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that the first group to enter paradise, to enter Jannah, will be as beautiful as the full moon. Allahu Akbar. Everyone will witness their beauty. They will be beautiful as the full moon. They will not spit. They will not blow their noses, nor will they excrete stool. They will not pass any najasa from their body. Their vessels, their utensils will be of gold. Their combs that they use to comb their hair will be of gold and silver. Their incense will be of the wood of aloe, and their sweat will be of musk. Allahu Akbar. Look at the description given to the first group of Jannah. Each one of them, when you go aboard the plane, you only see the air hostesses waiting to welcome you. But each one of them will be given two wives. Allahu Akbar. Just whilst they are entering Jannah, look at the privilege Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving them, the status and the honor. And look at the description of the two wives. The two wives will be of such beauty that their leg bones will be visible through their flesh. Scholars mention that this description is to highlight that their complexion will be immaculate. It will be blemish free. They will be so beautiful. Such a beauty has never been witnessed by man or jinn. Allahu Akbar. And their flesh will be sparkling white of extreme beauty. Allahu Akbar. There will be no differences amongst the first group of people who enter Jannah. There will be no hatred nor enmity towards one another. Their hearts will be like one heart. They will be united like one heart, and they will glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala morning and evening. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from that group. Now this group, let us imagine that we are from this group, and now we have been given two wives, we have been given all of these luxuries, and now we are entering Jannah. What happens? The gatekeepers, the malaika, will gather at the entrance and they will all cry out. They will all cry out to welcome this group. Salamun alaykum bima sabartum fa ni'ma uqbaddar. The malaika will cry out, Salamun alaykum, peace be upon you, bima sabartum, for the patience that you underwent, Allahu Akbar, for the patience that you withheld in this dunya, fa ni'ma uqbaddar, and excellent is the final home that you have achieved, Allahu Akbar. Peace be upon you for the patience that you undertook when you went through the trials of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the calamities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You bow patience from morning to evening, abstaining from food and water. Salamun alaykum, peace be upon you for that patience. You woke up in the night and you prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qiyamul layl, salatul taraweeh, at-tahajjud, all of these prayers. You went to the masjid for salatul fajr in the darkness. For all of that patience, you, the Muslim ummah, was battered from all four corners. And you bow patience. For that patience, may peace be upon you. Fa ni'ma uqbad dar. Excellent is the final resting place, is the final home. You have come home now. Now it is time to rest, and now it is time to enjoy. Allahu Akbar. The malaika will welcome this the first group uttering these statements, and these people will enter Jannah. Now the last person to enter Jannah, let's talk about him. The last person to enter Jannah, the hadith is amazing. And from that we realize the mercy of our beloved maker. Even upon the last person to enter Jannah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, the last person to enter Jannah will be a man who will walk staggering from one corner to the other, because he will come out from Jahannam. He's the last person to enter paradise. He will be put into Jahannam to purify him, and he'll be taken out and he will walk as if he's in a daze, as if somebody has clubbed him on the head. He'll walk as if in a daze, staggering, and he will walk as if a person who is in extreme pain. But once he comes out of the fire, he will turn towards the fire and say, blessed be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who saved me from you. Allah the Almighty has given me something that he did not give to the earlier and the later generations. And then suddenly what he will see is a tree will pop up from some out of nowhere. A tree will pop up. This hadith is in Muslim. A tree will pop up, and the minute he sees the tree, He will want to be, because so much of heat, and he would have underwent so much of pain and heat. The minute he sees that huge tree and water running beside it, he will say, "Ya Allah, oh my Allah, please let me take shade by that tree and let me quench my thirst drinking the water from that under that tree." The narration goes along the lines of these words. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "O son of Adam, O son of Adam, if I give you that, will you ask anything else from me?" Allahu Akbar. "If I answer your request, if I answer your wish, will you ask anything else from me?" To which that man will say, "No, ya Allah, I will not ask you anything else other than that. Please let me take rest by that tree." Allah the Almighty will grant him permission, and he will fall by that tree, resting under the shade and quenching his thirst. Whilst he is doing that, suddenly another tree will pop up a little more further. A tree even more beautiful than the first tree, and with more springs and more beauty. The minute he sees that tree, he'll say, "Ya Allah, let me take rest by that tree, Ya Allah." Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "O son of Adam, if I give you that request, if I answer your dua, will you ask anything else of me?" To which he will say, "No, Ya Allah, this is it, I won't ask you anything else." And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will permit him to move to that tree. The minute he sits by that tree, a third tree will pop up, even more larger, even more beautiful, even more cooling to him. And the minute he sees that tree, he will notice that it is by the gates of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. That tree is by the gates of Jannah. He say, "Ya Allah, let me please take shade, let me take rest under that tree, Ya Allah." To which Allah will say again, "Our beloved maker, the most merciful, the most beneficent." He will say, "O son of Adam, if I grant you your request, will you ask anything else of me?" To which he'll say, "No, Ya Allah, let me just take rest by that tree." To which Allah will answer that request of his too, and he will go under that tree. Now, whilst he's seated in that tree, he will hear the voices of the people of Jannah. He will hear the voices of the dwellers of Jannah, laughing, merrymaking, joking, in happiness. He will feel so much of sadness, so much of remorse, so much of guilt. He will say, "Ya Allah, oh my merciful Allah, let me enter Jannah, Ya Allah. Let me enter Jannah." And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "O son of Adam, O son of Adam, what do you want so that you will never ask me of anything else? Will it please you if I give you admittance into Jannah, and if I give you the world and as much as it in equal to it?" Allahu Akbar. "Will it please you if I admit you into Jannah and also give you the world equivalent to this world?" Allahu Akbar. Now this man will look up and he'll say, "Ya Allah, are you making fun of me, Ya Allah? Are you mocking me, Ya Allah, when you are the Rabbul Alameen? When you are the Rabbul Alameen, are you making fun of me?" And then the narrator of the hadith, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he smiles, Allahu Akbar. And then he tells the Sahaba, "Do you not want to ask me why I am smiling?" To which they ask him, "Why are you smiling, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu?" And then he says, "Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he also smiled at this juncture. And we too asked him, Ya Rasulullah, why are you smiling?" To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarified, "Because the Rabb of the worlds, the Lord of the worlds, the most merciful, the most beneficent, will smile on that day when this slave asks him, Oh Allah, are you making fun of me?" Allahu Akbar. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "Oh my beloved slave, I'm not making fun of you, but I am able to do whatever I will and whatever I choose." So he admits him into Jannah and he gives him equivalent to this world. And that's why scholars say that the last person to enter Jannah, his Jannah will be equivalent to this world and all it contains. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all entry into Jannah. I was to touch on the levels of paradise, but as I'm running out of time, I swiftly will move to a nutshell description of Jannah, which won't take a lot of time. And this was given to us by my beloved Shaykh Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. He writes it in his book, Hadil Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah. It is a beautiful book and a beautiful description by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. And he has taken references from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, If you ask about the ground, about the soil of Jannah, then know that it is musk and saffron. Allahu Akbar. If you ask about the roof of Jannah, if you ask about the roof of Jannah, then it is the arsh of Ar-Rahman. It is the throne of the Most Merciful. It is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you ask about the rocks and the stones of Jannah, then know it is pearls, jewels, rubies, diamonds. Allahu Akbar. Hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. In the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks about the Mi'raj, Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu states, from Abu Dharr radiyallahu anhu, in which Abu Dharr radiyallahu anhu states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up on Mi'raj, he says, I entered paradise and I saw lights of pearl and its soil, the soil of Jannah, was of musk. Allahu Akbar. It was made of musk. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah goes on to say, if you ask about the buildings of Jannah, if you ask about the buildings and the mansions and the dwellings and the houses of Jannah, then they are made of bricks of gold and silver. One brick of gold and then one brick of silver. Another brick of gold and another brick of silver. Allahu Akbar. I doubt we have ever thought about such architecture. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith in the beginning, I said, مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. It is something that no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, nor can it cross the imagination of any human being. Architecture of such beauty and of such excellence, made of gold and silver. And if you ask about the trees of Jannah, then the trees of Jannah, there won't be even a single tree, except that the trunks of those trees are made of gold and silver. And the fruits of those trees, they are softer than butter and sweeter than honey and softer than silk. Allahu Akbar. So luscious and so sweet, the fruits of Jannah. If you ask about the leaves of the trees of Jannah, then they are softer than the softest silk, than the softest cloth. If you ask about the rivers of Jannah, Allahu Akbar, the rivers are rivers of milk. Rivers of milk, its taste never changes. The milk never curdles. The milk never goes bad. It is milk, pure, unadulterated milk. Pure milk, luscious, sweet milk. And rivers of wine that is so sweet and so delicious that whoever drinks it will not suffer intoxication, will not suffer, in other words, hangovers the next day. It is so sweet and so tasty. Rivers of wine and rivers of honey that is pure, thick and luscious, and rivers of water that is sweet and fresh. Allahu Akbar. These are the rivers of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the noble Quran, مَثَلُ الْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي وُعِدَ الْمُتَّقُونَ, is the description of Jannah which the righteous, the people of taqwa, have been promised. فِيهَا أَنْهَارٌ مِّن مَّاءٍ غَيْرِ آسٍ, wherein are rivers of water, unaltered water, pure fresh water. وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن لَبَنٍ لَمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ طَعْمُهُ, and rivers of milk, the taste of which will never change. وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن خَمْرٍ لَذَّةٍ لِلشَّارِبِينَ, and rivers of wine, delicious to those who drink. وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن خَمْرٍ لَذَّةٍ لِلشَّارِبِينَ, وأنهار من عسل مصفى, and rivers of purified pure honey. ولهم فيها من كل الثمرات ومغفرة من ربهم, in which they will have from all kinds of fruits and the forgiveness from their Lord. Is that Jannah equal to كَمَنْ هُوَ خَالِدٌ فِي النَّارِ وَسُقُوا مَاءً حَمِيمًا فَقَطَّعَ أَمْعَاءَهُمْ. Is that Jannah equal to that of those who will abide eternally in the fire of Jahannam, and their drink will be drink that will scald their, it will be scalding water that will burn their skins and which will cut their intestines. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from the blazing fire of Jahannam, and may He grant us entry into Jannah. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim goes on to say, if you ask about the food of Jannah, then it is fruits from whatever you wish and whatever you choose. And it will be meat of the birds that you desire. If you ask about the drink of Jannah, it is tasneem. Allahu Akbar. It is tasneem, ginger and kafur, camphor mixed together. If you ask about the drinking goblets of Jannah, then they are crystal clear and made of gold and silver. If you ask about the shade of Jannah, the shade of each tree, a fast rider would have to ride for 100 years and he would not be able to cover the shade of Jannah. This is the description of Jannah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. If you ask about the tents and the encampments of Jannah, then one tent will be a concealed pearl. Out of one pearl, a tent will be made. This is why I said that this kind of architecture cannot be imagined by us. In one pearl, it will be hollowed out and it will be made as if into a tent. Allahu Akbar. And if you ask about how far it reaches into the sky, then look at the shining star that is visible. Just as how a star is visible to us, that is how far it would reach into the sky. But we would not know as to how far it would really reach. Allahu Akbar. And then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he goes on to mention in regard to the day of increase. Just another 5 minutes and I'll wrap it up. The day of increase. Yawmul Mazid. Allahu Akbar. This is a beautiful narration. He mentions this in his book and he states, he quotes from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once again, imagine with me, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Now we have entered Jannah. We have witnessed all of these pleasures, all of this happiness, all of the beauties and the luxuries of Jannah. Now just imagine all of us, this gathering. We are seated by the banks of the rivers of Jannah. We are talking, we are merrymaking, we are taking goblets and drinking from the milk of Jannah, the wine of Jannah, the water of Jannah. Whilst we are talking, we will be with whom? With our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, with our Salafun as-Salih, all of whom we love so much. On that day we will be with them, we will be talking to them, we will be sitting with them, and we will be with them at that moment and at that time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. A caller will call out, Allahu Akbar. A caller will call out, Ya Ahl al-Jannah, Ya Ahl al-Jannah, O people of Jannah, O inhabitants of Jannah, O dwellers of Jannah. The minute the people of Jannah, when we all hear that call, it will strike a chord in our hearts. It will strike fear in our hearts because we will think, is someone trying to take us away from Jannah? Now that we have witnessed all of these pleasures, all of these luxuries, why is someone calling us like that? Are we going to be taken out of Jannah? What is happening? Why is someone calling us? Why is someone calling us? We will be in fear at that moment. And then that caller will say, oh, people of Jannah, your Lord, Allah the Almighty, the most merciful, the most beneficent, He wishes that y'all should come and visit Him. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty wants us to come visit Him. The narration goes along the lines of these words, to which the caller will once again say, فَحَيَّ عَلَى زِيَارَتِهِ. So rush, come towards that appointment. Come and visit your Lord. To which we will all get up. We will all get up and we will say, سَمْعًا وَطَاعَةً. We will say, we hear, we obey, here we come. And we will all start moving towards a particular direction. Allahu Akbar. And then suddenly we would come across a mountain valley. When we come to that mountain valley, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order for His arsh to be brought there to that mountain valley. It will be like a valley, and the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be brought there. And at that moment, when we are witnessing that great spectacle, the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa, kama yaliku bi sha'nihi wa jalali, that arsh has now come in front of us. Whilst we are astounded by that spectacle, suddenly we will see manabir, members, pulpits of light popping up from everywhere. Pulpits of light, pulpits of gold, pulpits of silver, pulpits of rubies, emeralds, gems, jewels popping up. And for whom will those pulpits be? It will be for us to sit on. Allahu Akbar. Those pulpits will be for us to sit on. And then all of us will sit on those pulpits. And then the caller will call out again, Ya Ahl al-Jannah! Ya Ahl al-Jannah! O people of Jannah, you have a blessed appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which Allah the Almighty wishes to reward you all. Allahu Akbar. We will all say, what is this reward? Hasn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given us everything? We have been granted entry into Jannah. Allah promised us that, and we have been granted entry into Jannah. Now what more can we ask from Allah? What is this special reward? We will all cry out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved us from Jahannam. He put us into Jannah. So what is this special reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to bestow upon us? And then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, a sudden light will break out. A light will break out, filling the valley. And then all of us will raise our heads. All of us will raise our heads. And behold, Al-Jabbar, the compeller, Allah the Almighty will be there. Allahu Akbar, this is that appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalaluh, Azza wa Jal, Jalla wa Az, He will be there in front of us, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Ya Ahlal Jannah, O people of Jannah, Salamun Alaykum. Peace be upon you. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty will say, Ya Ahl al-Jannah, O people of Jannah, Salamun alaykum. May peace be upon you. Our beloved Maker, the Maker that we prostrate unto every single day, the Maker that we prostrate unto in the middle of the night, the Maker we cry unto, we will be in front of Him. And that Allah, that powerful Allah, He will say, Salamun alaykum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from those who will witness that salam. And what will we reply? What better a reply can we say other than that we would say, Allahumma anta as-salam wa minka as-salam tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Oh Allah, you are salam. Allahu Akbar, you are salam. Wa minka as-salam, and from you is salam, from you is peace. Tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Blessed are you, O possessor of majesty and honor. Allahu Akbar. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will smile and laugh and say unto us, O people of Jannah, Ya Ahl al-Jannah, O people of paradise, O my slaves, where are those slaves of mine who used to worship me without seeing me? Allahu Akbar. We have worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will say, where are those slaves of mine who used to worship me without even seeing me? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, this is the day of increase. This is Yawmul Mazid. This is the day of increase. Ask what you will, and I shall give it to you. Allahu Akbar. And then we will say, we will all say in unison, we will all say together, Ya Allah, you have granted everything to us. What more can you grant? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, this is the day of increase. Ask what you want, and I will grant you what you want. And then we will all say, Ya Allah, we are pleased. So be pleased with us. Be pleased with us, Ya Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, O people of paradise, O people of Jannah, if I was not pleased with you, I would not have made you from the people of Jannah. It is because I am pleased with you, that is why I have made you from the people of Jannah. Ask what you will, this is the day of increase, I will give you that. And then we will all say, Ya Allah, arina wajhaka nanzur ilayk. Ya Allah, show us your face. Show us your face so that we may see your face, Ya Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, I will give you all what you will. You ask what you want. And we will say, arina wajhaka nanzur ilayk. Ya Allah, show your face so that we will be able to see your face. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Jalla Jalaluh, He will remove the veil that covers his face. Hadith is in Muslim. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu states, "Inna Allah la yanam." Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not sleep. وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَن يَنَام. Nor does it befit His Majesty and His glory to sleep. يَخْفِضُ الْقِسْطَ وَيَرْفَعُ. He raises the scales of things and lowers them. يُرْفَعُ إِلَيْهِ عَمَلُ اللَّيْلِ قَبْلَ عَمَلِ النَّهَارِ. The deeds of the night go up to Him before the deeds of the day. The deeds of the day go up to Him before the deeds of the night. حِجَابُهُ النُّور. The veil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is made of light. لَوْ كَشَفَهُ لَأَحْرَقَتْ سُبْحَاتُ وَجِهِهِ مَنْتَهَا إِلَيْهِ بَصَرُهُ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to remove that veil, the light of His face would burn every single creation in the path of His sight. And the scholars, rahimahumullah, they say that would mean that every single creation, every single atom, every single molecule will burn to ashes, because nothing is hidden from the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But on that day, when we say we want to see the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Almighty will remove His veil, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decree that the light of His face should not burn any one of us. And we will be astounded. We will be riveted. We will be enthralled. We will be gazing at the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that pleasure, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there will be no pleasure equivalent to that. The pleasures of Jannah will be nothing in comparison to the pleasure of looking at the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the pinnacle of pleasure. That is the ultimate pleasure a believer can attain. May Allah the Almighty make us all from those who will attain that pinnacle of pleasure and look at the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He forgive all of our sins. May He accept our good deeds. May He accept our fasting. And may He grant us entry into Jannah amongst the first groups to enter Jannah. And may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us here today on this fasting day with our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhir da'waya an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Whatever correct said was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there was anything wrong in what I said, it was from me and shaitan. I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the accursed devil, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. Jazakumullahu khair. Subhanallah.